I'm Judy Shaw for NYSE Floor Talk. Joining me today is Aaron Tan. He is CEO and founder of Karo. And we also have Ernest Chu, who is the CFO at Karo. Gentlemen, it's great to have you both on the show. Thank you so much for joining me. But before we get started, I just want to say a quick note to our viewers. This interview is for informational purposes only. The NYSE doesn't recommend any investments or investment strategies. Okay, so now, Aaron, I want to kick it off with you. The online used car marketplace in Southeast Asia is in an emerging stage. How has COVID-19 impacted industry trends?
So one of the key trends that we have saw really over the last year or two really is the acceleration of e-commerce across Southeast Asia, right? And within which what we are most interested in is the online commerce part of stuff. You know, as people realize and start realizing, to be honest, that they are able to buy cars and sell cars entirely online without ever seeing a salesman ever again. And for us, you know, over the last year itself, revenues grew more than 2.5 times. And honestly, this is not too bad given the fact that, you know, more than 3 months over the last year itself, we were in lockdown mode, right? Which basically means that most of us couldn't even travel out of our house, right? But that said, online penetration for auto is still overall less than 1% of the ASEAN market. We expect significant growth moving forward, and COVID has been a huge catalyst for our business. Yeah, but I think one of the biggest trend that we are seeing in this part of the world really is acceleration of e-commerce, even for automotive in this part of the world.
Now, tell me about Karo's vision and what some of your key achievements are.
So our vision really is simply to provide our customers with an AI-driven car experience, right? So an AI by itself is a really big word, right? But one that we are very uniquely positioned to achieve. 50% of the management team has a computer science degree, right? And in fact, AI and deep learning today is really a big, big part of our business, right? We try to apply it to everything that we do, right? For even for simple things like for sales, right? You may be talking to a sales representative over the phone, you know, in Karo, but you may not know that actually it's being powered by machine learning and strong NLP techniques, right? Whereby you're actually speaking to the machines and you may not even know that you're speaking to the machine because at the end of the day, we try to make AI part of this this whole journey of how we are dealing with the customers. And this really helps us and differentiates us with, you know, the competition, so to speak. Or even if you talk about selling cars, right? You know, when the mechanics are able to just take a picture of the vehicles itself and detect what are the defects that we can see, you know, through things like computer vision and stuff like that, right? So we are able to do all this thing mainly because of the fact that we really deploy AI across everything that we do, right? Now back to vision, right? At the end of the day, really, at the end of how we think about life is simply to provide our customers with the best level of experience, all right, and one that is filled with AI and automation so that one doesn't have to face another used car dealer ever again, you know, if they want to buy a vehicle or sell one for that matter.
All right, now, Ernest, how have recent initiatives and industry trends translated into numbers for Karo?
We capitalized on the situation and spent a lot of time, frankly, to put in place initiatives that turned out to accelerate our growth plans massively over the last 12 months. We put in place methods and structures to improve the sustainability of our business. We just closed our financial year end with a strong March. March revenues recorded 70% month-on-month growth. So on a full year basis, as Aaron said, we achieved a very, very respectable 2.5 times revenue growth. A number I felt is outstanding in the context of a challenging last 12 months. We continue to demonstrate that we can be very profitable, or profitable at least, without burning significant marketing costs. OPEX structure is very lean. For the second year, we are EBITDA positive. EBITDA grew despite the challenge we had. There is almost no operational burn. Now, looking forward, we are well on track to achieve profitable revenue growth of about $1 billion run rate by next year. We aim to continue hitting 2 to 3 times growth rate in the next couple of years. We also expect margins to expand as we build on our ancillaries.
All right, now tell us more about what Karo has done as a startup to secure liquidity and financial flexibility.
That's a pretty important part of a startup. Now, increasing financing lines to about $150 million over the last couple of months has been pretty astounding for us, and we are in discussions for more. Unlike other startups, there is good lending appetite towards Karo, And I think it boils down to ability to prove that we are growing and we are growing profitably in a sustainable manner. This is critical to fund the increasing inventory size and working capital requirements, as well as financing and vertical subscription businesses. To cater to our strong existing investor appetite, we are also in the midst of completing a heavily oversubscribed internal funding round. We didn't need too much, but it's a very nice one to have.
All right, and finally, Aaron, does Caro have any plans for another fundraising round, an IPO, or a de-SPAC?
Yeah, as Ernest alluded to, we're actually in the process of closing a relatively big round right this second. But you know, in terms of IPO de-SPAC, with you know, especially given what Grab and what C is doing right now today, you know, we are I would say at this point in time undecided. But you know, I always tell Ernest this, which is all options are on the table, right? You know, 12 months, 18 months, 24 months, we do not know, right? But at this point in time, we are still relatively undecided because currently we are still not pressed for liquidity, and you know, we have a very strong balance sheet currently, right? But that said, you know, we are seeing very strong investor appetite from what we are doing. I mean, sectorially, so to speak, our valuation environment is super attractive, particularly for high growth companies, and you know, companies that is even EBITDA positive like us, it's hard to come by. So you know, we're seeing a lot of interest, you know, be it from the SPAC target standpoint, or even like potentially even listing directly, right? But at the end of the day, for us internally, it's really the most important thing is to secure high quality investors, right? Because they can value add our cap table, because at the end of the day, we do really want to work with strong individuals or rather strong institutions that can bring the company to the next level.
All right. Well, Aaron, Ernest, it's been wonderful to have you on the show. Thank you both for joining me on NYC Floor Talk.
Thank you, Judy.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.